Hi, I'm Don Kettl. I'm a professor of public affairs at the LBJ School at the University of Texas at Austin. And today what we want to do is to explore the issues of leadership in crisis, the challenge of trying to get government to move quickly, and to move in ways that are effective at a time when enormous problems require the very best that government can do, and where so often it seems that government is so deeply challenged in trying to rise to that occasion. To be able to do that, I want to explore three different things. One is a set of lessons that we know from past crises about what it is that makes effective leadership work. Secondly, there's a conversation with Admiral Thad Allen, who was in many ways the hero of New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina. He was brought in by the president to do what seemed to be impossible to get done, to really get government to work effectively, to help to attack the problems that had been crippling the city and punishing the people who lived there. And finally, there's a story I want to share in the end about how these lessons come together. And to make the point that leadership in crisis is something we know something about, that's something we can learn how to do, and something that we have in many ways the imperative to figure out how to do better. But to get at this, I want to begin with the words of one of the great American philosophers, the philosopher Tom Cruise in the movie Top Gun from 1986. And in that movie, he sits there and sitting in his plane and then walking across the tarmac says, "I feel the need for speed." And the issue in crises and in crisis management in particular is that we have problems that we want to solve, but that what we need to do is to figure out how to solve them quickly, about how to try to make sure that government is galvanized to action, and that at a time when we face enormous problems, we feel the need for speed and can make that success work in a way that is quick and effective and it solves the problems. And to be able to get at that problem, what we want to try to do is to explore some of the big issues that in fact we face. What kind of lessons do we have about what it is that effective leadership in crises means? The first lesson that we want to try to explore here is defining the problem for everyone. That the first and most important thing in the middle of a crisis is to know what the problem is that we're trying to solve. That is a deceptively complex and a deceptively important piece, because so often we have players going off in different directions, all sure that they're solving the problem, in many cases not even trying to solve the same problem, and sadly, in some cases, not solving the right problem. The important lesson here, in fact, comes from President Franklin Roosevelt, who, in the very first speech that he gave to the American people after his inauguration, in fact, in the very first paragraph of that speech, he says that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. There in the middle of the Depression, there in the middle of an economic collapse, of social calamity, of a crisis the likes of which the country had never seen before, with all the different kinds of challenges and issues that we were facing, he defined the problem that we had to solve as a problem of fear, and said that when we attack the problem of fear, then we don't need to fear it any longer. His basic strategy of leadership here was convincing people that he had this problem. He knew it. He understood it. And he was going to, by his leadership, help to allow everyone else to push their fear aside and to move toward solution. This first and important lesson of the importance of crisis management is to understand the importance, first of all, of defining the problem and defining the right problem. And that really takes us then to the second issue. The second lesson for leadership is putting first things first, because we always have the problem in a crisis of trying to deal with issues, of challenges, of figuring out what it is that we need to try to do first to solve the problem. Because there are always, and this is the nature of crises, so many things that need to be done. It seems like all of these things have to be done all at the same time. And of course, we can never do everything at once. We sometimes can't even figure out which thing to do first. Understanding that what we need to do first is what it is that flows directly out of solving the right problem is one of the things that's most important about crisis leadership. In the issue of COVID-19, the most important thing to do first, as it turns out now, is testing. What kind of problem is it? Who has the problem? Where is it located? How fast is it spreading? And then as we look forward to the future as well, to the question of, in the longer run, how the country, how the world can best manage the crisis. The issue has to do with understanding how we gradually release the standards of social distancing, how we begin to get back to a normal, and how do we define what normal will be. All of that depends on tests and having a good testing regime. And so without good tests, none of the rest of it really matters. So it's a matter of understanding which problem is the problem we need to focus on, which problem do we need to focus on first. The third lesson that we need to try to focus on then is the problem of leveraging partners for results. Because there are two things I want to suggest here. One is that in the middle of anything that really matters, there's nobody who could possibly be in charge of everything. The world is just too complex and the problems are moving too fast for anyone to be in charge of everything. But the other point I want to make is that it's impossible for anybody to really be in charge of anything. That the ways in which problems get solved and the way in which different resources come to bear are often so complex that no leader can sit there and simply snap their fingers or give orders and expect things to flow. That what we really have is a system where we rely on vast and complex networks that in some cases have supplies of masks, have supplies of ventilators. There are issues about where it is that the hospital beds are going to be coming from. Who has how many intensive care unit beds? How do we connect the state departments of public health with local health authorities? Who has the assets at the federal level? In short, how does all this come together? And the lesson here is that not only do we need to understand what the problem is and what problem needs to be tackled first, but we need to understand that effective results means building partnerships among the people who have to contribute to solutions. Because the simple fact is that nobody's in charge of everything. And in fact, nobody's really in charge of anything. It's only by leveraging results through partnerships that we can ever get anything done. The fourth lesson that we have is the importance of connecting assets to problems. That, in fact, so much of what really goes on and what needs to be done is finding ways to connect what we have with the problems that need to be solved. There's an interesting story that happened in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans. It turned out that as boats were trying to navigate the streets of New Orleans, and that is the boats were going down the streets of New Orleans because the streets were flooded. The boats continually were put out of action because the propellers were getting clogged by all the debris. And the problem was how to try to get the boats into action, and many of the boats that they had simply didn't work given all the debris in the streets. Somebody said, I've got an idea. There are some boats that we purchased up in Michigan, and these boats were designed to scoot across frozen lakes to rescue people who were stuck out on lakes when there was no other way to be able to get to them. And the thing about those boats is that they were designed not to have propellers in the water, but to scoot across the top. Somebody said, I bet they'd work in New Orleans in those streets because they wouldn't have propellers that stuck in as deep in the water and ran the same risks of getting all clogged up in the process. So they bought some of these special boats that were up in Michigan down to New Orleans. They put them in the water, and sure enough, they worked. And using the right kind of assets, maybe assets not even designed for the original problem, to try to attack the problem at hand, turned out to produce a remarkably successful solution to a problem that, in the end, was a problem that had to get solved. And that gets to our fifth lesson, which is finding ways of protecting the heroes, finding those who are in charge of making all these things happen and making sure that their work is protected. So much of the work, of course, requires the work of skilled bureaucrats, of administrators who know the details and know how to get things done. But the underlying piece about bureaucracy is that people rarely are rewarded for doing good work well. They often are punished for making mistakes. And in the middle of a crisis, the demand for doing a lot of work fast means that the odds of making mistakes increase and that the odds of protecting oneself and following the standard operating procedures and having that lead to success, on the other hand, are very tiny. And so the problem is trying to figure out, how do you get people to take risks? One of the basic problems in the middle of a crisis, and this is a lesson that we learn over and over again, is that standard operating procedures don't work in so many cases. We need people to be able to use their ingenuity, to use their imagination, to use their expertise, and use it to solve the other four lessons that we have talked about previously, to try to find ways of bringing all that together. That in fact, the basic issue here is trying to ensure that as we learn those lessons, defining the problem for everyone, of putting first things first, leveraging partners for results, and connecting assets to problems, that we can protect the people who are taking the risks that are needed to get things done. Those are the things that, as it turns out, are the cornerstones for making leadership work. I mean, how can we be sure that this will work? Let me share some of the thoughts from Admiral Allen based on his experience in New Orleans and the challenge of trying to figure out how leadership in crisis can actually work. We have a great interview with him, and let me share that with you now. And good morning. This is Don Kettl from the LBJ School at the University of Texas at Austin. And with us today for a conversation about the implications of leadership of the COVID coronavirus is Admiral Thad Allen, who not only led the American response to Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans, but also was the incident commander in response to the Deepwater Horizon. And Admiral Allen, I want to begin today with a question about just your general observations about the issues of leadership in a major crisis like this. You've got a wide range of experience. How, from your perspective, do things look, and what kind of advice would you give?
Well, I guess first I'd note that every one of these major crises actually becomes an exercise in applied civics and tests social contracts and expectations in all levels of government. But underpinning everything, in my view, has to be transparency. Wherever there's ambiguity, it should be removed, creating clarity where you can, and be open and honest with the American public at all levels about what the problem is and how you're trying to solve it. That's the only way you build credibility with the American public, and the only way you can create a whole of government or whole of America response is to create a cause for action that everybody can believe in.
And that part is interesting because there's been some research on what leadership really means, and a central part that some people, including there's a historian Robert Tucker, who argues that one of the most important things that leaders can do is just to define the situation for everybody else, not so much just to produce results, but to define the situation. And can you talk about that, both based on your experience and what you think that might have to do with the coronavirus today?
Sure, and I think it's an excellent point. Many times we start responding to a crisis without really understanding what the crisis is or having a framework by which to understand it. The best example I can give you is when I was sent down to New Orleans on the 5th of September, a week after Hurricane Katrina came ashore. And I was sent down to support Mike Brown, but go to New Orleans and try and solve the problems that were there. When I flew into New Orleans on the morning of the 6th of September, I had this feeling that I was like in the pit of my stomach that we had gotten the problem wrong. And after a couple of short conversations, I realized that we weren't dealing with a hurricane. We were doing emergency declarations and flowing resources in and had been for a week. But the fact of the matter was the city of New Orleans lost their command and control capability, and the real problem was continuity of government. And if we didn't address that, we weren't going to be able to fix everything else. So the way I explain Katrina, at least in the world according to Allen, is that the city was a victim of a weapon of mass effect, but there was no terrorism or criminality involved. And as a result of that, they lost continuity of government. It didn't allow them to take the resources that were being provided them to any kind of effect. Once we understood that, we could organize a response that would be responsive to the problems that were there and increase the credibility of the people that were involved.
How big of a stretch is it to say that the coronavirus is pretty similar to the definition that you just gave, except for the fact that we can't really see it compared to the fact that New Orleans clearly was underwater?
Well, I think the level of complexity is off the charts on this one. And when I think about complex situations, and Katrina, Superstorm Sandy, and the oil spill were all complex, but the level of magnitude for this problem is just horrendous. And one of the issues with complexity is you know that you're moving into a different area with a problem when existing legal frameworks and structures and doctrines for thinking about things don't apply anymore. Where you see ambiguous legal boundaries. You see people not honoring contracts, say, for waste disposal as they did during the Ebola crisis. All of a sudden, complexity in itself becomes a risk factor. And in this case, it's not just restricted to a particular region, a county or a city or a state. It's all 50 states and the territories of the United States simultaneously. So the level of complexity is remarkable. And ultimately, it's going to boil down, in my view, to that interaction between the federal government and the state and local governments, which under the 10th Amendment have the responsibility for crisis and disaster response.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that's interesting, because we tend to think about command authority too often, and often wrongly, looking at your experience, as a matter of giving orders and saying, I'm going to command, here's what needs to be done, as opposed to finding ways of using command authority to build the kind of collaborations and partnerships. And I was wondering if you could just spend a moment talking about the kind of friction between the way we think about command and what leadership in situations like this actually look like.
Yeah, I think you're dead on. Let me make a distinction, though, to inform the discussion. I want to make a distinction between unity of command and unity of effort. In the Department of Defense, under Title 10 U.S. Code, there is a legal chain of command from a private clear to the president. It can be described in legal terms, and anybody in the military is subject to the Uniform Code of Military Justice, and it's enforced. Once you move outside military operations or outside a particular line of authority, the best you're ever going to achieve is unity of effort. And so the question is, how do you put a structure in place that allows you to integrate both horizontally and vertically across governments and the private sector, be able to co-produce the outcomes that are required to address the problem? That's going to be a little bit novel in each situation, but the ability to be able to do that is the key to solving the problem, in my view.
And what are the key pieces, do you think, that are best equipped to try to help produce that unity of effort that you're talking about?
Well, the first thing is transparency of information, so everybody's dealing with the same set of facts. Then the ability to draw together a consensus over what the mission is and the outcomes you're trying to achieve. And that has to be done without regard to politics, is usually the operational outcome that you want. It won't involve politics. It involves actually deploying resources and solving a problem. And once you get that, you have a basis for trust. And to the extent you have pre-need relationships where you work these things out before, that's even enhanced further. But the bottom line for me is transparency of information, building of trust, and building a consensus you're going to co-produce the outcomes together.
And that's such an interesting approach to things, because so often, again, we tend to think about leadership in situations like this as sitting in the desk giving orders. And remember back to Harry Truman's great comment about Eisenhower saying, here's the general coming in, he's going to pound in the desk saying, do this, do that, and nothing's going to happen. And saying that leadership, at least from Truman's point of view, was such a different kind of approach.
Yeah, one of my favorite definitions of leadership, and I can never remember where I heard it, is the ability to reconcile opportunity and competency. So you have a supply and a demand issue, and the issue is how do we make that most effective and efficient to the ends of the American people.
And here we've got a case where it's opportunity on the one side, competency on the other, and the fact that the assets that we need to bring to bear are scattered in so many different places, and public and private and federal and state and local, and the challenge is trying to find a way to weave all that together.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And what makes it even harder is the aggregate amount of resources available may not be adequate to the problem we're going to face, which means we're going to have to allocate scarcity. That makes the challenge of integrating a response and trying to achieve a consensus even more difficult. But in the absence of being able to come up with a way to allocate scarcity, you're going to let it become random, and you're probably not going to optimize what you could do to minimize the impact of the event. That's the reason it's going to be so important that there has to be an operational social contract between the federal government, the state and local governments, and how this thing's going to move forward.
And from your experience, what kind of advice would you have for somebody who finds himself sitting in that chair and whose job is to try to produce that unity of effort that in the end it's clear that we need?
Well, my general organizational prescription for these things, regardless of who's in the White House at the particular time, is that you need a professional subject matter expert that's focusing on fixing the problem without regard to politics. It needs to be accountable to political leaders. And then that person needs to be given the authority with the company and accountability. And then they need to be able to speak openly and honestly to the American public about the problem at hand. I did almost daily press conferences both during the hurricane and the oil spill. And I thought what allowed us to be somewhat successful in both of them was that I had credibility with the American people about what I was saying and what I was doing, and politics didn't enter into it. Anytime you combine politics with line operations, you know, you're in great danger of screwing both of them up.
Yeah, a fascinating point. And I want to conclude our conversation here today. If I could ask you just to tell the story about what was it was like when you hit the ground in New Orleans, and you tell a story about having arrived on the ground and bringing the troops together in that first morning and trying to find a way to drive them and to stir them to action. And could you tell us that story as we finish up here this morning?
Sure. Just by way of background, I arrived in New Orleans on the morning of the 6th September. In about 72 to 96 hours, we had basically unified the response between the Joint Task Force under U.S. Northern Command, the local National Guard, and the state and local authorities there in New Orleans. On the 9th of September, that Friday, I was called to Baton Rouge by Secretary Chertoff. He called me into a private office and said there was going to be a press conference in 30 minutes and that I was going to relieve Mike Brown of the entire coastal response for the entire Gulf region. He then told Mike Brown that we had a very, very uncomfortable news conference, after which Secretary Chertoff left, and Mike Brown went back to Washington and resigned a few days later as a FEMA administrator. On my way into the building that morning, I had run into a FEMA employee, and I talked to her for a bit, and she told me how uplifting and rewarding the work was. But she told me that every night when she went back to her hotel room, all she saw was her organization and her leaders vilified. It was very, very hard to keep her morale up. So after Mike Brown and Secretary Chertoff left, I gathered everybody I could in a big open space, and I got on a desk with a loudhailer. And I told everybody how the transition was going to work, and then I looked at everybody and I said, I'm going to give you an order. Now, I had no legal authority to give anybody an order, but there's an old saying, you don't have sovereignty unless you can exert it, so I gave it my best shot. And I told them they were to treat everybody they came in contact with who was impacted by the storm as if they were a member of their own family. Their mother, father, brother, sister, and so forth. I said, if you do that, two things are going to happen. If you make a mistake, you're probably going to err on the side of doing too much. And at this point in the response, I'm okay with that. The second issue is if somebody has a problem with what you're doing, their problem's with me, not you. And at that point, people started openly weeping, and there was a collective sigh that changed the barometric pressure in the building. Nobody ever told these people in real simple terms what the mission was, that there was a basis for trust and to build a consensus, but more importantly, nobody ever told those people that somebody had their back.
Stunning story. And there are some of those lessons that carry through very clearly to today. And that's something that I'm glad that you've had a chance to be able to share with all of us. And want to wish you continued good luck, wish us continued good luck, and wish us the wisdom to follow what it is that you've laid out here. So, Admiral Allen, thanks so much for joining us today. Really, truly appreciate your comments and your thoughts. And thanks again.
My pleasure, Al.
So if you sit and listen carefully to the lessons that Admiral Allen talks about in that story, you'll see that he touches on all of the things that we had mentioned earlier. There's important lessons about how to try to lead in issues of crises, but in particular, how important it was to build on the people process, that protecting the heroes was so incredibly important, using that to try to encourage people to take the risks that they need to take to be able to solve the problem that needs to be solved. Let me give one other story to illustrate the way in which this so often works, especially if you've got leaders who know what they're doing. The story begins something like this. A few years ago, I was giving a talk at the FBI in Washington, and I thought it had gone fairly well, although that's an audience that you want to be careful in front of because there were lots of people who were heavily armed between me and the door, and I wanted to make sure I could get out alive. But at the end of it, there was one very tall guy who was standing in the corner and just motioned with his finger to me, said, come over, I want to talk. Again, he was between me and the door, and it was clear he had a bulge in his pocket and had a gun, so I figured I'd better talk to him. And he said, I want to tell you a story. The story is this. On the morning of 9/11, I was head of the FBI GO team in Washington. That is, if anything really bad happened, I was the one who had to lead the charge to help stage the FBI's response. And I was, like everybody else, watching the video of the planes hitting the towers and knowing that we were in the middle of one of the biggest crime scenes we were ever going to see. But on top of that, what I also knew was that the FBI field office in New York was in the process of being destroyed along with that, and I was going to be sent up to Washington, from Washington up to New York to try to solve that problem. The time he said, I was a bachelor, and so I hadn't done my laundry in weeks. I went running home to throw some stuff in the washing machine, and on the way back, I heard a report that a plane had just hit the Pentagon. And so I hit the light bar on my FBI car, went flying across the 14th Street Bridge in Washington just before total chaos erupted and nothing was moving, pulled into the front of the Pentagon 8 minutes after the plane had hit. 8 minutes there, and here I was, the senior federal law enforcement official on the scene, and what I did was to surrender control of the scene to the chief of the Arlington County Fire Department. And if you stop and ask yourself, in what movie have you ever seen that happen? Could you imagine ever that the senior federal law enforcement officer on the scene would surrender control to a local fire chief? How did that happen? Well, the reason why that happened was that the team that was there involved local law enforcement, local firefighters, involved the National Park Service, the FBI, and a whole coalition of organizations that together had responsibility for emergency response in the Washington area. And for years, they had been practicing with each other about what would happen if something really bad happened. And it turns out that 48 hours earlier, they had had one of these drills. They had practiced what was going on. They had practiced how to respond. What they were practicing about had nothing to do with a plane hitting the Pentagon. But what they had managed to do was establish trust with each other and a sense of each other's competence and an agreement that if anything really bad happened, whoever it was who had charge of the competency that was needed at that moment would have command of the scene. A fascinating case of leadership in crisis where all those lessons that we talked about earlier come to the fore. First, defining the problem and understanding that you have agreement on what the problem is, putting first things first and finding ways of putting out the fire, which at that point was the thing that had to be done to try to save lives, of creating leverage among partners because nobody's in charge of everything, and in fact, nobody's even in charge of anything, that only by working together could they solve the problem, that as a matter of connecting assets to problems and finding ways in particular that the FBI could support the efforts of local firefighters to solve the problem, and finally, protecting the heroes, because here was a case where the entire team was taking an enormous amount of risk to try to make sure that what had to be done at the time was done to save the people who were inside that burning building and whose lives that morning were saved because of the leadership in crisis that the people there succeeded in exercising. So what we know is that there are lessons about leadership in crisis, that leadership in crisis can work, that there's some basic lessons that we can know and that we can follow, that these are lessons that have been proven in crises in the past, and they're lessons as well that give us important insights about how, given all what we face with COVID-19, that we can use and carry forward an effort to try to have government serve the needs of the American people. It's been such a great pleasure having a chance to be able to share these ideas and wish all of us successful leadership to try to attack the problems that we know that we all need to solve.